Needless to say, all this, yes, over 150 publications, many students. So all these things, perhaps everyone knows, but the things that only those who are familiar with him may know is his interest in movies, literature. And when I say movies, it's not just the Akira Kurosawa or Satyajit Ray, not just that, but even he's very much knowledgeable about, say, Rohit Shetty's or Karan Johar's movies. So his interest spans from right from Kurosawa to Rohit Shetty. Then that quality I have always noted, with the ease with which he can give a lecture about quantum mechanics, he can have the same conversation at a tea shop that is somewhere in a remote place or in some corners of the fort area. I have the opportunity to be with him in such occasions. And he adds this little bit of humor and theatrics even to rather mundane things and make it interesting. Hope in this topic also we will be able to hear some of those physics as well as some of those interesting touch of humor, art, poetry, and the list goes on. So I welcome Prof. Vijay Singh to give his talk.
Thank you. I hope I turn, is this on? No. Can you turn this on? Who is the expert?
I am not the expert, but I can try.
Am I clearly audible in the back? Okay, that's it. Thank you very much, Masood, for a very effusive, introduction. So I hope I don't disappoint. And let me try. Okay. And I see only friends here and a couple of not so friends, but okay. I'll do my best. Okay. Okay. This is basically physics and the city of Mumbai. Okay. So we begin now. Okay, so this, most of us, and I'm no exceptions, I've spent a substantial portion of my life in what was once Bombay and what is now Mumbai. Okay, so, and I think many of us in this audience have the same background of having spent a substantial portion of their lives in Mumbai. Okay. And basically, we are all attached to it, and we are all experts. Okay, I mean, we are all experts on Mumbai. So I thought we all have been exposed to, how should I put it, to news about Mumbai, okay, to poetry about Mumbai, to literature about, stories about Mumbai, okay, but perhaps not to the physics of Mumbai. So I thought I will share some of my thoughts with you. And this is supposed to be a light-hearted talk, so, and it's supposed to be fully understandable to everybody. Okay, maybe with the exception of just one formula, which I will use in the end, but so you'll have to excuse me for that. But 100 years ago, there was actually a shire or a poet. He had come from from Lucknow, and he saw Mumbai. He had come with expectations about Mumbai, and he was atop Malabar Hill. Okay. And he saw the glittering lights of marine lines, which is called the Queen's Necklace. Okay. And then he was awed by it. And then he went to Haji Ali, and this is what he said. This is Haji Ali. He saw the crimson sunset at Haji Ali. Okay. And he said, Khushnama Bombay tujh pe peeron ka saya. Khushnama Bombay tujh pe peeron ka saya. Jaisa suna tha, tujhe vaisa hi paya. That is, praise or blessed be Bombay. May the saints be benevolent to you, to Bombay, and you have met all my expectations. Okay. So the first sight you see is this minaret, and the first question that comes to us, yes. Is why is there a minar? So the word minar comes from the Arabic word manara, which means basically lighthouse, because it acts as a lighthouse, okay, And it is basically a signaling tower at sea. That's what the Arabic word means. Okay. And why do we have it? Hey, we have it because the Earth is round. And we have a problem called the horizon problem. That is, if the Earth was flat, you could see till infinity. Of course, air pollution not being there. Okay. So you could see to a great distance. But if it's round, then there is a horizon problem. And the first thing we would like to understand is this horizon problem. Okay. So the Earth is round. Okay. This is the round Earth. This is the radius of the Earth. This is the height of the manara or the minaret. And then you can see all the way up to the tangent, which is x, the distance x. And this is a right angle triangle. Okay. And you use Pythagoras theorem. It's also Arabert's theorem or whoever's. Okay. And we just use it. And I think this diagram is better. Okay. As I said, this talk is not for you, Prithvijit. Okay, R plus H. Okay, R plus H, the whole square minus R square is equal to, I should have called it D, X, it's X square. And what you do is make an approximation. So that's the way you understand most things. If you make an approximation to a very difficult equation, such as this, you say R square plus H square, and then this R square minus R square cancels out. And the H is very small. It's only about 20 meters, 30 meters, compared to R, which is 6,400 kilometers. So because of that, you make that approximation, you come across a very simple formula, which is 2R into H. Now what is R? R is the radius of the Earth. So 2 times R is 6,400 kilometers. And if you take the appropriate, and if H is in meters, by the way, it's only 20 meters or 50 meters, or at the most 100 meters. Okay. Then 2 times R, you just think of a number, square root of that is just 3.6. You do 3.6, and whatever the H is, you take the square root of that. Okay. So I will take an example right now. And for the Haji Ali, in fact, if you go atop Haji Ali, this is what will happen. It is 85 feet tall. So it's 25 meters. So the square root of 25 is very simple. It's just 5. And if 5 into 3.6, that's just 18 kilometers. That is how far you can see, provided there is no pollution. Yeah, please come in. Provided there is no pollution, that's the furthest you can see. I'm really sorry. Should we get some chairs? Because I... Okay. Yeah, we'll get... So that's... And if you're a human being, basically your height is about 2 meters. So you take the square root of that and you can barely see about 5 kilometers. Okay. So that is how far you see, and it is the horizon problem. Now, I will first continue with the introduction and then I will come to the main body of the talk. Okay. So, but if you don't understand something, please stop me. And sometimes you have more interesting comments to make than I do. So please make those. Okay. So let's begin with a few comparisons. This is Mumbai's history, okay? In 1661, Catherine Braganza married King Charles II, and even they had dowry. It's not just the Indians who are the culprits, even they had dowry. So they have, Bombay was given, or Mumbai was given as a dowry by the Portuguese to whom it belonged, and they gave it to England, okay? It's almost like saying, okay, here it is, and you take this Bombay, okay? What was happening in England at that time? In England, Robert Boyle had discovered Boyle's law. That is, the pressure is inversely proportional to volume if the temperature is constant. So he had discovered that law. Okay. Then around 1668-69, the British East India Company, which is the biggest multinational corporation ever, okay, and you should look up the article in the Guardian about it, the biggest multinational corporation, it leased 7 islands of Mumbai from King Charles. He took the 7 islands and said, give it to us. What was happening? In England, their first scientific publication came out. That was in 1665. Okay. And 1687, a very pivotal year for Mumbai, the headquarters of Mumbai shifted from Surat to Mumbai. And in 1687, we all know, if we are from physics, that Newton published the Principia. Okay, So what was happening is, on one side, we were groaning under colonialism, and on the other, the colonialists were doing very well scientifically. Okay. And in order to tell you, there's another story. It reminds me about Manhattan. It's the same story there. There was a Dutchman who actually sold Manhattan to England for some 30 guilders or something, for about some small amount, and that Manhattan didn't even belong to him. It belonged to the Red Indians, and he just sold it. So this has been the story of colonialism as far as India we are concerned. Okay. So that's a little bit of history there. Let us do the geography. What were these seven islands, by the way? These seven islands that were leased. So they are not to be shown in great detail over here, but these, the seven islands, were all of this yellow portion. Okay. And there's at the far end, at the far north, is this island of Mahim, okay, where I spent my boyhood. Okay, and I'm very attached to that place. So Mahim is actually a wonderful place, I have to tell you that. It is the most cosmopolitan place it was in the world. Okay, it has one-third Hindus, one-third Muslims, and one-third Christians. And among the Muslims, I mean, they were also differentiated. There were Shia and Sunnis. Then there were Boras, then there were Ismailis, there was Khojas, a smattering of Ahmadiyyas, and what have you. Okay. And among the Hindus, of course, I mean, we are very diverse. I mean, you know, there was the Chandrasenia Kayas Prabhus and the Pathare Prabhus. And then there was the Chitrapura Saraswats and the Gaud Saraswats. And depending on whom you talk to, the other guy was inferior to them. I mean, that's, I mean, we have, you know, and it was always like that. You know. We always looked down on the others. Okay, so I grew up there. So I couldn't resist telling you, sharing this thing about. It basically reflects all our boyhood and our nostalgia and our love for the city. Okay. And if you can see this, this is actually north-south. Okay, this is the southern tip, this is the northern tip, and you have Mumbai city, which is the island city, it's called. It's about 70 kilometers square. And the rest of it is about 370 kilometers square. Okay, the suburban part, where we all live now, and most of us live there, except unless you live in the TIIFR colony. Okay, then of course you live right here. Okay. And our population is, you know, I kept losing track, and I kept studying this thing for, I think it was 16 million, and then it became 18 million, and perhaps it's 20 right now. And the population density is enormously high, 40,000 or more per square kilometer. Okay, so that's the geography. But you can see it's north-south. And the way physicists try to understand this is by saying it has a metric. The road map, the roads of Mumbai follow what is called the Manhattan metric. So I have to tell you what is the Manhattan metric. Okay? So the Manhattan metric is something like this. Of course, it's not Manhattan, but this is Manhattan. Yeah. Okay? Manhattan is like Mumbai. Of course, I told you the history. The history is also similar to Mumbai. Okay? It was gifted to England. It is south, and this is north, and this is Central Park, and there are avenues which run north to south, and there is a large number of streets which run east to west, but the streets are shorter, the avenues are very long. Okay, that's the way it works for Manhattan. Okay, and this right angle roads is called the Manhattan metric, and most island cities tend to have the Manhattan metric. Okay, even if you look at Bombay or Mumbai, okay, it is the same. There is the Muhammad Ali Road, which starts on one side and goes all the way down, and of course you give it different names as it goes, Baba Sahib Ambedkar, VN Purao, and it is just nothing but the Muhammad Ali Road. Okay. On the other side, there was something called the Lady Jamshedji Road, which also ran a long distance, but now we give it different names depending on whom we want to please. So, okay. As opposed to that, there's the Moscow metric. The Moscow metric basically is radial. It starts off from the Kremlin and it goes and spreads like this. Okay. So Mumbai has got the Manhattan metric. Delhi from Connaught Place has the Moscow metric. Okay. So as a first approximation to the road map, you think of it either as a Manhattan metric or as a Moscow metric. Okay. But I have to tell you one thing now. This work that we did was done in the Olympiad cell. And with each of the people who worked with me, I mean, although they were not physics people, we did some physics work. So this particular work was done with the help of Sana. She is right here. So she did, it's a collaborative work, and our mutual love for Mumbai made us do this. And there's a similar piece of work, which I hope I can present sometime, that I did with Suchita, and a third one which I did with Ranjana. So I have to acknowledge, thank you. Okay. So now coming to the main body of the talk. If you have been in Mumbai for about 5 years, you know, 10 years or 20 years, there are some pivotal experiences. There are some things that you always have. You know, I'll share with you, and you will also come back and share something, a story with me. Okay. So there are four or five of them that I would like to address, and I will make some comments about them. Okay. Which are the ones? Mumbai rains. Okay. I mean, all of us have some stories to share, and you get wet at least once every monsoon in spite of your precautions. Okay. So there is just a picture of the Mumbai rains. Okay. And, you know, always this, and if there's nothing to, you know, if you want to make small talk, I mean, there's always the rain, and there's something else which I will tell you, and if you're lost, there are at least five topics, then you can start a conversation with that in Mumbai. Okay. One of them, of course, is the weather, and particularly during the rainy season. Will it rain today? Will it not rain today? You know, what a bad day, or I lost my umbrella, or something like that. Something, okay. So this is, I think there was a very, catastrophic rainfall. When I first joined here, I think it happened in the same year or the next year. We had a very heavy rains for about 6 or 7 hours, and that actually flooded Mumbai. Okay. And there were stories about how people were trapped inside the car and they were not able to push out. Okay. Because their electronic system failed, the windows were locked, the windows were closed, and they just couldn't push themselves out. Now the question is it true or is it not true? Okay. So we can analyze it, okay, that they were really not able to push out. So how do we understand this? We understand it by saying, okay, my weight or my mass is about 80 kg, at the most it's 100 kg, and I can exert a force which is 10 times that, 10 times because of gravity. G is the gravitational constant, so the force I can exert is 100 into 10, that is 1000 newtons is what I can exert from inside. What can be exerted from the outside? It would surprise you. From the outside, even a very conservative estimate will tell you that it is 5000 newtons. And here is the calculation. As I said, there are only two equations I will show you. This is one of them, and I couldn't avoid doing it. Basically, there's a pressure on the door. So if there is a lot of flood, if there's a lot of water, the water exerts pressure on the door. Now, what kind of a pressure does it exert? It exerts a pressure which is given by a formula. The formula is rho into g into h. Rho is the density of water, which is 1000. G is 10, forget whatever it is. And h is the height of the water. Let us put it as 1 meter. So if you take 1000 into 10, it is 10,000 already, okay? And the water is at least 1 meter up there, outside, so it's about 5,000 newtons, 5,000 pascals, say. Okay. Thank you very much. So it's about 5,000 pascals. Now, what is force? Force is pressure into area. Most people have difficulty. See, whenever you introduce a physics quantity, it is incumbent on you to explain why you're introducing. I mean, supposing I talk about epistemology. What is the meaning of this term? Why do you use this big term or something, epistemology? So when you talk about pressure, why is pressure so important? Okay. Pressure is more important than force at times. See, for example, when you take a syringe needle and you poke yourself with it, when the doctor pokes you with it, okay, it's a very small force. It's a force of only 1 newton. But the area is so small, so minuscule, that force divided by area becomes very large, and therefore it punctures your skin. We have all been in circuses where we see people demonstrating how an elephant can stand on your chest, and another person is not killed. Nothing happens to him. The rib cage, the rib bone doesn't break. That is also very simple. That is because what he does or she does is she puts a plank on top. The plank makes it a large area. So even though the force is large, okay, the pressure is large at one point, it is divided over the area, so the pressure is very low, okay, overall. Okay, so that is what is happening. So basically the force is nothing but pressure into the area, okay, and that is about 5,000 newtons. Okay, so area is about 1 meter square. Let us say the outside door of the car, we say one, it's a very conservative estimate, it's more than 1 meter square, but let's call it 1 meter square, it's more like 2 into 2, it's 4 meters square. So it's 5,000 newtons. And all that you can exert from the inside is about 1,000 newtons. So you're trapped. So it is plausible. The stories that you heard is probably, it's a plausible story. Maybe it never happened, but it is a plausible story. You can get trapped. So people never think of water in these terms, but it is quite lethal at times. Okay. The other topic is, of course, the Mumbai trains. Okay, we all know about the trains. I mean, trains is the lifeline of Mumbai. Okay, lifeline it is. Okay, and let me tell you some history about it. It started in 1853. Okay, it started with a 14-coach steam engine. It traveled from, I think some of us are from Thane. It travels from CST to Thane in about 1 hour and 15 minutes. Okay, making two stops along the way, Sion and Baikala. Okay, that was a long time ago. But how long did it take? 1 hour and 15 minutes. Just 1 hour and 15 minutes. Okay. How long does it take now? It takes 1 hour. That's a great improvement. About 1 minute every 10 years is what we have improved on. So it takes and stops at 18 stations. So basically, I thought I'll give you the small statistics. I'll give you grim statistics also. Okay, lifeline it is, but the Mumbai local trains are also life takers. Okay, it's the artery, but this artery, they say Mumbai local is the artery, but this artery is bleeding. Okay, here's a small calculation. Okay, if you have been here for 20 years, you would know somebody who is gone because of the Mumbai local. Okay, and I know of three people. One of them, several of us know here, but I will not name him. Okay. What is the speed of a fast train? It's about 90 kilometers per hour, 25 meters per second. Okay. And supposing you are trapped, say, in front of an approaching fast train, and somehow you cannot move, you know, something has happened to you, you have fallen down and you cannot move. The question is, can you survive? If you are 100 meters away, now I want an answer, okay. 100 meters, yes or no? Give me any answer. I mean, you can either be right or wrong. Actually, the answer should be no. What about 200 meters? Yes or no? Come on. No, very good. 300 meters? Yes? Yes or no? 400 meters?
Yes.
Yes. Very good. 500 meters? Definitely yes. Answer is no. Okay. The answer is no because the maximum deacceleration that a train can do is minus 0.5 meters per second square. If it did anything more than that, the train would jump. And then the train driver would be killing a lot more people than this one person he's trying to save. Okay, so this is the maximum. This is a number that people don't quite appreciate. It's very, very small. Okay, and then you use a simple formula. And in this formula, this is the final velocity, which has to be zero. This is the initial velocity, which is 25. I said it's 25 meters per second, which is 90 kilometers per hour. It's a real fast train. Okay, and the acceleration, as I said, is minus 0.5. So if I take minus 0.5 and multiply by 2, I get 1. Okay, and if I take this 25 and square it, I get 625. And therefore, the distance is 625 meters. So even if you are half a kilometer ahead, the driver in the fast train cannot stop. Okay, and often you are less. And you haven't even considered the reaction time. The driver has to see and then stop. That reaction time could be 2 seconds. In that time, it has already traveled 50 meters because it's moving at 25 meters per second. 25 into 2 is 50, so you get 50 meters. So 675. So never ever cross the railway track. Yes, you look. I'm saying you're trapped there. You can't move. Huh? That's true. You can do that calculation. and that's usually shown in movies. You know, if you see most of the movies by Salman Khan, I mean, he's just crossing in no time at all. Right? So I'll tell you another thing. The real reason it happens, I think, is probably psychological. There are three reasons, and let me tell you. One is that if you do an activity every day, which is not right, then you get used to it, it becomes a habit, and you think you can do it. Supposing you've done it for 100 days, by the law of induction, you can do it for the 101 day. So that is one, habit. The number two thing is, when the trains, I mean, this has been noticed already, when they blow the horn, it is so loud that instead of flight, you freeze. Okay, so it's just flight or freeze, and it's free, you tend to freeze when you hear that loud sound, okay, unsuspectingly. And the third thing is actually a very interesting psychology. Okay, what happens is, if you have a very long object, and if much longer than you, and if it is moving slowly, or it's moving very fast, you tend to think that it is moving slowly. Okay, that is because you calculate its speed with respect to its length. It's a psychological thing, it's a biological thing. You know, it's a long thing, and you see, oh, it's moving fast, but you think it is moving slowly. That is why you have these phrases like an elephant lumbers along, but an elephant can catch you in no time, okay, and maul you. And that is why you have this phrase, an ant is scurrying along. You use the word scurrying because it's running or something. Actually, it's very slow, but compared to its length, it is very fast. Okay, so that is why it's happening. So a big train is coming, you think, oh, bahut dheere dheere chal raha hai. No, it doesn't matter. No, I can cross, and you cannot. Okay. There's another one which I should tell you about. It's also very interesting. I have to tell you a little bit about a principle called Bernoulli's principle. The way I explain it to students is that when the stock ends, everybody will make for the door. So near the door, there is a lot of pressure. The velocity decreases. Okay, no, nobody can go in, and we start jostling over here. And once you come out, the pressure is low, and then you run to the canteen. Okay. So similarly, pressure is large, velocity is low. Okay, and vice versa. So a plane flies, one of the reasons, I mean, they're not the only one, is that the way it is designed is that most of the air, okay, flows up. So the pressure is low there. And the air below is moving slowly below it, so the pressure is high, so it's actually lifting the plane. High pressure below, low pressure above. Okay. The same thing happens on railway tracks. You are asked not to stand close to a fast train. Okay, the reason is because the fast train is dragging. Okay, let me show you. The fast train is dragging the air. Because it is dragging the air, the velocity is large, the pressure is low. Behind you, the air is stationary, so it's pushing you inside. Okay, so I used to have an old Maharashtrian lady who said, "Nahi jaye sabala." Okay, don't go near the railway track because there is a booth. It's called railway line ka bhoot. Okay, why is it a bhoot? Because she thought the spirits of the people who have been killed by railway trains are restless and they want you. And so when you go there, they just drag you inside. Okay, so it's called railway line chi bhoot. Okay, so but whatever, bhoot or otherwise, bhoot or Bernoulli. Bernoulli or bhoot, don't go near the railway track. Whichever one you want to accept, it is fine, but you don't go near the railway track. And you know, this is a very dangerous activity. Okay. Third problem, always a matter of conversation, housing problem. Okay. We are always, you know, like, how much is your flat? The first question they will ask, do you own it? Yes. How much is it? If you don't own it, how much rent do you pay? I mean, you know, and then, you know, everybody and his brother is an expert on the real estate of Mumbai. Okay, that is one thing. And you can see how the real estates are, you know. I mean, you know, these are the real estates of Mumbai. We all face a housing problem, okay, because we are all ordinary people, ordinary mortals, okay, and that is what happens. How do we deal with it? Okay, how do we try to understand the housing problem? Population density is very high, 40,000 people per square kilometer, okay. So you deal with it by understanding something called surface to volume. Somehow you have to increase the surface, okay. And one way to understand this problem, but not the housing problem, is to see this church. It's a church from Mumbai. I think it's St. Michael's Church in Mahim. Okay. So you see this church. It has large windows. Why does it have large windows? Because the surface area, the nutrition that the church is getting, the light, is from the windows. Supposing it was all covered or something like that, then there would be no light coming in. So you try to increase the surface area from which you get the nutrition. In this case, nutrition is light. So if you look at many of the Hindu temples, it's all very dark, because we didn't think of this as something, you know, like we should put windows on our, in our mandir or something like that. Our sanctum sanctorum are all very dark or something like that. And therefore we light a lot of diyas. Okay. There's another one. Even the modern malls have this so-called top thing which gets you light. Okay. So surface to volume is a very important law, and it cuts across anything. I mean, if you cannot explain, this is the one law which even beats Newton's second law, because this one law works in many places. Okay. It also works as far as the housing problem goes. Let me show you an example. You see, this is from Dharavi. Okay. This lady is actually very interested, very intelligent, I would say, because she is making papad. But if she just put it on a flat, she could only fit 10 papad. But she is putting it on a curved surface. She is going into the third dimension. So going to the third dimension is giving her extra mileage, you know, an extra surface to put it on. So she has surface to volume is increased. So she is putting more papad, and she is actually making a little bit more money than her neighbor who doesn't think of this idea. Okay. Everywhere is a surface. You go into the third dimension, double-decker bus. Look at our trains, you know, there are triple-decker trains. Okay, and look at these people. I'm not recommending it, but you know, I can see why this happens. You know, to understand something is not to condone it. Okay. But I can understand why they are doing that, because they can't fit in here. All our skyscrapers, I mean, you know, we go into the third dimension. In fact, the Mumbai skyline is like any other skyline. Look at Tokyo, you look at New York, you look at anything, Singapore, all the skylines are similar. And I have done a small fractal calculation for this, but I don't think I'll present it here. But you can do a calculate the fractal dimension of the skyline of most cities. Okay. Surface to volume here also. These are our so-called airports now, modern airports. How do they increase the surface? By actually putting a lot of air jetties outside, so they can fit more planes. Area cannot increase, but by putting these jetties, you have increased the number of places for these planes to park. Okay, so this is almost like the villi of the small intestine, or like the modern bath towel, where you actually put out small, which dries you better. You increase the surface area. Okay, so that is the... That's what I have to say about the housing problem. I have many other things, but this is, I would leave it with this, okay? Now let's go to the ceiling. Now ceiling is not a very common topic. I mean, we just built it in the last 10 years, but there's something about the ceiling, and I will have somebody assist me in this, because it's very interesting. If you come from the Bandra side, okay, you can see the ceiling. The ceiling is this double-stayed cable. It's like cable on this side, and on the other side also there are these cables which fan out, at least about 40-50 of them. But if you come from the Bandra side, next time you come, you watch this, okay? Next time you come, there will be a pattern of these fans, and there will be another pattern behind it of these same fans, and as you go, you'll see a very interesting pattern emerging, okay? A wavy pattern that emerges. Okay, those are called Moire patterns. First, I'll show them to you. This is the kind of pattern you will see. You will get these things like this. Okay, these Moire patterns, when I first saw it, I was very thrilled, because you know, I had not seen it before in a real situation in Mumbai. But this is called Moire patterns. Okay, and let me just share something with you. Can you help me with this? Someone has to help me. You can also do it and play around with this Moire patterns. And you can give it back, yeah. Oh, this. I don't think this will work. This at this. Okay? This I'll give you more so they can all see this. Okay. Then this one also. Take this one also.
Okay. How many do you have?
This is it. I'll show you something else. Where can you get Moire patterns? You can get Moire patterns provided you travel in second class, not first class. Okay, and provided you provided you are at these various intersections at times in a taxi or in an auto. People come around, these kids, small kids, trying to sell you. Wherever I go, I always buy one. Okay, because you can get all kinds of running pictures with these moiré patterns. You see what it is? You know, you must have all, so next time please buy it and you can help, you can understand what a moiré pattern is. Give one on this side. Please return all of this in the end, okay? So in 1890s, if you remember, I mean, okay. This is a gift, there's a question at the end. Whoever answers will get a moiré pattern from me. Okay, so that is what I will do. Oh well, I'm doing all right with time, I think. So the story is in 1890s. Now, we didn't have movies in those days, no? 1880s, 1890s. So the way they made movies was by making story books with moiré patterns. So you have Jack and the Beanstalk moving around and the beanstalk growing and so on and so forth. And Little Red Riding Hood walking or something in that forest. And the wolf eating her or something, or grandmother, I think. Not her, but her grandmother. So all these moiré patterns are there. But now it went out of fashion as soon as what is called Chalchitra or the movies came. Okay. But here is something I found very interesting, that new 2,000 rupee and 500 rupee notes. And, they have interesting patterns, and for a while I wondered what are these patterns. Then I Xeroxed one, which is illegal. Okay. I made another one, which is also illegal, so two illegal acts. And then you move one on top of the other, and that is how I make out if my 2,000 rupee note is fake or not. Okay. And then I found that, interestingly, even the German currency now actually does moiré patterns to find out if it is forgery or not. Okay. Somehow the person with whom I shared this, he took away these fake 500 rupee notes. So this is not very good. Okay, 2,000 rupee notes. So it's not very good. But if you try hard, you can see a moiré pattern. You don't look at the main thing. Don't look at Gandhiji. Look at those, you know, very intricate patterns. Put one on top of each other. I blew it up. You know, and this is courtesy Suchita in the Olympiad lab. I got it all done, you know, and then you just move it around and you'll get it. So moiré patterns are there and they are just wonderful things. Okay. The second class compartments you can get it, intersections you can get it. You see here, there's a moiré pattern again. Take two grids. Move them against each other. Why are they used? They're used to find out small imperfections. Okay, that's why the moiré pattern is used. Here it is. Yeah. And basically, it is the analog of what is called interference phenomena, which establish the wave nature of light. So that's moiré patterns right here. Okay. So that's about the C-link. Now let me tell you about, so this is not the main thing, people don't talk about it, but we talk about some scientific institutions of Mumbai. So since I have 15 minutes, can I take 10 minutes? Okay. So scientific institutions of Mumbai, and Mumbai is associated with many great scientific institutions, okay. And this is probably the greatest, okay, the Kolaba Observatory in 1826. It maintains a continuous geomagnetic record starting from 1850s or so. For 150 years, it's actually a world-class institution in that world regarded for the maintenance of geomagnetic record. What they do is they measure the magnetic field, but the magnetic field we know is 3.1 in whatever unit, it's called Gauss. It's 3.1 Gauss, but they are not interested in the 3.1, they are interested in the variation, the diurnal variation, the seasonal variation. You know, if there's a sunstorm, what happens to it? So they actually measure it. Okay. And one of the greatest sunstorms took place in 1857 when we had our independence war. It was very big and it was called a huge storm came, so-called storm came, and all throughout the earth. Okay. And they have that record too. Okay. All their instruments went haywire at that time. Okay. So this is the magnetic observatory. It was in Kolaba. But it had great people in it. And I have to tell you one story which is scientifically related. It has to do with trams and the Kolaba Observatory. How many people know this story? Oh, then I'm going to tell you a very interesting story. You know, trams were introduced in 1874, okay, in Bombay. I don't know when they were introduced in Calcutta, but in Mumbai it was 1874, and they were drawn by horses. You can see these horses. There it is. Where did mine go? Okay, I lost somehow. Okay, doesn't matter. Okay. So after that, around 1900, they decided to do away with horses, and they wanted to make electric trams to run from Parel all the way to Kulaba. But then the director of the Kulaba Observatory stood up. His name was a Parsi gentleman. His name was Nana Bhai Moose. And Nana Bhai Moose said, I will not allow this tram. Okay. Because the trams will use electric current. The electric current will produce a small magnetic field. It will interfere with my observations. Okay. So here it is. But first I'll show you the trams. These are all these interesting double-decker trams are also there. I don't know if some of us were, I've been on trams in Mumbai. Up to King, it used to run up to King Circle then. Okay. And you know, there was a terminus in King Circle, so it would go around, and as small boys you would just jump on it and go all the way around, and the conductor would try to get us off. You know. So this is some brief history of the trams. Okay. It is basically double-decker trams in 19, and it stopped in 64. So if you were born after 64, you never saw it. Okay, you never saw these trams, in Mumbai at least. In Calcutta, of course, they are still around. Okay. So what was the controversy? So Mr. Nana Bhai Moose said, I will not allow it. Here is a small calculation, which you may or may not be interested in. If the current is large, the magnetic field is large. The current is proportional to the magnetic field. I'm taking the distance r. R is the distance between the current and the observatory. It's 100 meters. So I'm taking that to be 100 meters. I get a quantity like 0.0004 Gauss, whereas the Earth's magnetic field is 3.1 Gauss. Okay, but the measurements are of that level. Even in those days, the measurements went up to this. Now they go up to nanotesla or something. But they go even three zeros further. So it's 0.3 zeros, it now goes up to 6 zeros. But in those days, the measurements were up to this order, and therefore Mr. Moose, Nana Bhai Moose, was very annoyed, and he said, I will not allow it, and he stood his ground. From 1900 to 1907, he did not allow the trams. Okay. I wish some of our present-day directors would stand up like that, you know, in IITs or whatever, you know, instead of keeling over every time the government coughs. And they get government sneezes and they get a cold or influenza or something like that. Okay. So this is what happened. Okay. What did he do? He said, wait, I will shift my observatory to a similar isoclinic line in Alibag and build one there. Until it is done, don't bring the trams. And it took about 7 years to build it. I think I have a picture of that Alibag one. And I think you have been to Alibag. Rahul is from there. So this is that Alibag Observatory. A great story about the Alibag Observatory was that every brick that was put there was magnetically tested to be neutral. Because if it had some iron in it, it would have some magnetism in it, and it would be something which would destroy his, you know, which would interfere with his measurements. Okay. So some of you should go to Alibag and see this. It might be a nice experience. Another one is the Bombay Natural History Society, another great institution. Okay. It started in 1883. Few of us know that from 1912 to 1924, they carried out the first citizen science initiative ever, and the largest, I think. For 12 years, they wrote to their, how should I put it, their members. This is a voluntary organization, purely voluntary. He wrote to them across India to say, we want to collect mammalian species. And they collected 5,000 of them. 5,000 specimens, not species, 5,000 specimens. They identified 47 new species. Several were new. Okay. And for 12 years they did this effort. It is usually associated with ornithology or bird watching, but they have done some great work in the other fields also. And this 1912 to 1924, a great project, I would like to talk about it sometime. And how they carried it out. Okay. Another one, of course, is VJTI. The chairman, the present chairman of DIE, is a product of VJTI. Shekhar Basu, is it? Yes. Hafkin Institute. Okay. The others you all know about. TMC, Royal Institute of Science, where some of us may have studied. That's in Kolaba. TIFR, BRC, IIT, and of course the Indian Institute of Geomagnetism, which is now shifted to Panvel. Okay, there are two recent ones you probably don't know about. I'll tell you about them now. This is the Gemmological Institute of India, founded in 1971. Okay, so I made a visit there. They have equipment which would rival even TIFR, the kind of equipment for diamond testing that they have. They run courses which are basically which actually equip you to do diamond testing. Okay, gemmological courses, jewelry making courses. You can all register for it on the side. I mean, like it's a option. It's what is called a long distance. What is it called? Off campus course, and it's actually quite interesting. You can learn a lot about gemology. All the gems are over here. Okay, there's this, what is called Muktika. That is pearl, and this is ruby, and this is blue sapphire, and so on and so forth. And there are many others. So this is one of them, and their lab is in Sukh Sagar in Chowpatty, okay, on the fourth floor. And actually, believe me, I've been there. So has Sana, so has Ranjana. I've taken my PAs there also. So they have seen this. And they've actually, that's the one time they got to test, to actually hold a diamond, which is this big or this small or so on. And, you know, and one after another, at least 30, 40 diamonds, we all saw them. I mean, at least that was enough. I mean, what is it called? Of course, the Indian Women's Science Association. There's another one, 73. There's probably one of the later. So this is another. And I think several of our people are there. I think Mrs. Mahajan, Professor Mahajan is there right now. I think Chitra was there. So this is the institutions. Okay. And since I have five more, you'll have to give me five more minutes. This is Bombay and Bollywood. If you don't talk about Bollywood, it's not worth it. You know, Bombay and Bollywood is a love-hate relationship. You know, all these guys are there. Okay, all these scenes that you see in movies, which are all bunkum. Okay, I will not even bother to analyze them. You cannot do any of them. Okay, here is a guy. I don't know who is he. The car is moving this way. He's actually going in the backward direction. He's getting out in the backward direction. Only yesterday in Thane, 2 days ago, it's in newspapers, day before yesterday, a person tried to do the same. He fell backwards, he broke his head, and he died. So, I mean, I don't even bother to analyze all this. Okay, because it's just also off the wall to do the physics of the, and there are sites which do it, by the way. I would rather do something which is more interesting, and let me share it with you. Here's from the Raj Kapoor scene, okay. You see this moonlight, you know. So I wanted to capture this moonlight with my equations. Okay. But let me just play it for you, that scene. It's a 20-second scene. And I'll tell you which scene it is. Oh no. Very beautifully done. I mean, it just ends on that note. Of that note, you know, we don't know what's going on after that, but okay, that's and then they leave it at that, you know. So I thought I would try to write some equations for it, and I wrote it so I will not bore you with it, but the thing is actually quite, the model is simple. What is it? Oh, expand it, okay. I need to expand this. So what the model I can say, the derivation I will not talk about. So here is the lake, and there is waves in the lake, okay. So basically, the maximum angle that it makes or from which the moon can reflect is say alpha, say 10 degrees or something. I said it's like alpha is about 10 degrees. It's on both sides. I mean, the wave reflects like that, so it's about 10 degrees here, 10 degrees here. The moon comes and it reflects here where the photographer is, where he's photographing it. And then you actually calculate how big, how much is the shadow or the reflection, how much is the reflection like? So you don't have to focus on anything else, just focus on the denominator here. there is something called theta and 2 alpha. So now alpha is very small, it's a light breeze moving, it's not like a big hurricane moving over the lake, okay. So it's about 10 degrees or 20 degrees. And if the moon is also low, okay, on the horizon, it's also about 20 degrees, you are bound to get a 0 minus 0 in the denominator, and like 20 minus 20 say, or 10 minus 10, or 0.1 minus 0.1, so you get bound to get a 0 in the denominator, so you'll get a very long reflection. And what you have here, AB, oh, I didn't write that AB, the AB is this distance, how long is that reflection? So I wanted to calculate that. Just to capture that one scene, I put in a lot of effort, and I failed. I mean, I just couldn't do it. So all that I got was this insight that if the moon is low, and something that you've seen, if you've been to the seashore, you've seen it, if the sun is low, and you are here, you'll see a very long reflection of the sun. Okay, so I failed, so I just wanted to tell you that. But there's another scene, again from Raj Kapoor's Shri 420. Okay, it's a wonderful scene. You see, this is high, and this reflection is very small. But look at some other reflections. This one, for example. The reflection of this thing, it's very long. So it captures, my equations capture this thing to some extent qualitatively. I'm not saying quantitatively, but qualitatively. Okay. So I sort of try to work around this. There's another one which you all know about. It's from the Mughal-e-Azam scene, and it is very difficult to capture. Only thing is you can make it. Okay. It was made with these mirrors, which are made of Belgian glasses. It was made from Firozabad. K. Asif did it, and you will not believe it. After he did it, I'm not sure if this is right, he destroyed the whole thing. So that nobody else could make it. Okay. But the Sheesh Mahal you'll find in several places in India. You'll find it in Jaipur, it's in Lahore. It's one place in Maharashtra also, I forget where. Okay. There's that Bajirao Mastani scene. Okay. What the scene is, Bajirao is standing here. There's a mirror. See, this guy is pointing to the mirror. It gets reflected. There's one reflector here, there's another reflector here, and it gets reflected on the screen. It's called the Aina Mahal scene, and it's a very famous scene because in the end, I think the protagonist who's standing over here, she burns it. You know, because she sees a scene that she doesn't like. Okay. So that can be captured. In fact, I'm planning to buy some mirrors so that when I do another talk, I will actually demonstrate this. Okay. So here is the object. Here is Mr. Bajirao. And this is how it is. This is the concave mirror. So the concave mirror there, there's a plane mirror here, and you can capture it on over here. Okay. Just a concave mirror and a plane mirror may be able to capture it, but perhaps Rajesh has a better idea, so he can tell us more. So with this, I think I have just one lighthearted comment about, because beaches and movies, I have to put it together. I don't have much time for that, so I thought I'll do this one. You can see this panipuri, and these are two actors who are having this panipuri. What about a panipuri? What is the volume of a panipuri? So, you know, we got into the volume business. Can you guess? What is the volume of a panipuri? And also we bought a lot of panipuris. Actually, we did it in the Olympiad laboratory, in the Olympiad office, we did all this. Okay, we bought a lot of panipuris and measured it. The average is about 15 cc. If you take 6 of it, it's like 90 cc. 100 cc is what it is. It's excellent. Okay, because excellent, why? Because if you have, this is my solution to juvenile diarrhea. Because it has got salt in it, it has sugar in it, it has got tamarind in it, and if you have, you know, oral rehydration therapy for which some Bangladeshi is getting almost a Nobel Prize, I should be getting a Nobel Prize for proposing this as the solution for juvenile diarrhea. You have panipuri.
Huh? Yeah?
No, no. You have clean water, no? You have clean water, I mean. Okay, so thank you very much.
Sometimes people survive and then they die. So have you ever calculated like what is the distance from, I mean, you stand in the middle to where you are saying, but if you're standing too close, you get sucked into the train. So
yes.
How safe is it to stand in?
Oh no, I have not done this. But you know, you can stand between tracks and still survive. But it's not recommended.
But a lot of lightmen do it.
Yeah.
Railway
Okay. Yes, yes. They shouldn't, you know, it's actually a very dangerous activity even for them, you know. Yes. Yes. Huh.
Why is it difficult to create a fake model pattern with a fake note?
With a what?
You say that you can test out a note.
Yeah, perhaps. Yes, the German ones are doing it that way. Yeah.
So
yes.
Why is it hard to, make it a genuine note which doesn't reproduce, does the reproduction of the body?
Oh, why can't the counterfeit reproduce it? Is what you're asking.
No, but even a small imperfection would do it, would give you a problem there. See, the point is, it has to be exactly those patterns, and those patterns are very intricate on these 500 and 1000 rupees, 2000 rupee notes. They are very intricate, right? Now I want to counterfeit it, okay? I'll make some mistake. So if I make some mistake.
You need to be having expert eyes to do take.
Yes.
Data,
yes.
Right?
Yes. Yes. So what you do is you put one behind the other, or you know, I don't think they do it this way. They don't do that in the banks. But this would be one way that they would finally detect a very good fake. Say. As a normal rule, it's hard to see it as a normal thing. But you can do it. In fact, the German currency is now using Moire patterns.
So they test it out in the same way that you are doing, holding against bright light? And
no, they have tested out against a similar thing, and there is a light from behind. They have a counterfeit tester, and they test it out against that, you know, to see if there's a wavy pattern coming. That is what they do. Yes.
No, it's actually they, by making, they draw lines, and the lines by fibers. So usually in fake notes, they print it. So the mechanism of making their note is, so you cannot actually make a fake note with Moire.
Or pichel.
So it's a way of making them.
Yes.
And that's true with Indian.
So it is one way to detect fake currency, that is all. Yeah. Yes, yes. No, I've done a few, the traffic, what's called a traffic wave problem.
Yeah.
There's something called a traffic wave problem. As you come to an intersection, with what speed should you come that you can move slowly, okay? Now, I have done some modeling, but I cannot present it. I thought maybe for this talk I cannot present it. The traffic problem in Mumbai is very bad now. It is a nightmare, you know. It's not a traffic jam, it's called a traffic snarl. You know, that's the word they use, you know. So that's all. Yeah? Yeah, there is also about the Dabawala thing. You can. There are several such ideas. I have not analyzed them because they do a perfect job apparently.
I think outsiders talk about the Dabawalas more than Mumbaikers do.
Yeah. After some
iconic of the city.
Yeah, see. Yeah. Dabawala, how they do this management, yes. It's a good thing to look into. What are the other traffic? Dabawala, what else? Mumbai beaches also one could do some analysis. You know, how the plastic gets, pollution. Pollution is a big thing, and we are trying to write up something on that. Noise pollution, air pollution.
Get out of the train, stand in line for a rickshaw, stand in line for everything, which is not
true
so
most
in most cities.
Yes.
I guess we're done about here. Everyone's invited to tea and
okay. Thank you.
Thank you.